Hi, this is Shirish Kulkarni, founder and CEO of Stroth Consultech, having been run this company for last 5 years, focusing on small and medium businesses for their growth. And with this Hatke as an interview series, we have been talking to various industrialists, various leaders, various thought leaders, eminent personalities who have done difference, not only at Indian level, but also international level. And we have a great privilege to have none other than Dr. Mashelkar with us. I bow to him. Thank you, Doctor. तुम्ही actually माझं दैवत आहात. पहिल्यापासून you have been my inspiration, so I am just blessed to even have you here. So he is the one who is a global thought leader and proud Indian, has been recipient of 3 highest civilian awards in India, the brain behind innovation and IP rights in India, having played various roles in various research and in the educational space. You know, just to start, doctor, I wanted to ask, you know, I was reading one of the book, it is referred ki that you know, you are been referred as dangerous optimist. So I got curious. I was very careful even to utter that word to you, but what's the perspective of you know, being optimist, and how do you relate to it?
Well, I in Marathi, as we said, durdamme ashavadi. I think that's a proper way of putting it. Look, I personally believe that there are always 2 ways of looking at anything that you see. For example, if you keep a half glass full and a half glass empty, then people will look at just the empty part of it and write editorials on that and keep on cribbing about it. I look at the full part of it, basically. If there is a darkness suddenly, then people who are sitting there, they will start cursing the darkness. My mindset is different. I go and bring out, say, a candle to light up. So I've never tried to be a part of a problem, always a part of a solution, so as to say. And many times, your aspirations are your possibilities, your dreams are your possibilities. So dreaming big also makes you sort of achieve things. Super. And also there is a way of looking at things. You know, I remember, just to illustrate the point, Delhi University Physics Teachers Association had invited me to inaugurate something, and they were very discontented at that time. They wanted to take a morcha on vice chancellor's office because there was some problem there and so on. And the person who introduced me, like you did just now, introduced me, and then he said, as you know, we are all in coma and Dr. Mashelkar will tell us what to do. So I had just 30 seconds to just walk to the stage, even less than that, and say something. And I said, maybe the gentleman did not mean to say that he, we are in coma, but he meant we are at a coma.
At a coma.
Swalpaviram, coma.
Swalpaviram, yeah.
And what is the beauty of that coma? That you have written half sentence, you have to still write the remaining sentence, and then the next one, and then the para, then the page, then the chapter, and it can become a golden chapter if you write that sort of positively. And sort of a miraculous effect. So after I left, they were supposed to take moja, but there was a discussion. And then anybody who said anything negative, they said, what did Professor Mashelkar say? Not coma, but comma. And they dropped going there. So it's a question of looking at the thing, you know, and bringing the positive energy out of it. So there is a convocation that I've given on what is called as embracing the religion of positivism, where I've said that even in a country like India, where everybody looks at it negatively, all this, etc., how in everything we can find basically a solution. So right from my childhood, I have developed this sort of tendency. So what happened, Narayanamurthy on the other day in a public meeting said, whenever I'm depressed, which is very rarely, his wife Sudha tells him, "Hey Murthy, why don't you call Mashelkar?" So that's the way life. Yeah,
it's like You know, it's not dangerous optimist, but I would call it as it's like a medicine that you have. You are source of energy, source of positivity, and
That's
it's
right.
all flowing. Actually, it could be called as, in Sanskrit, it's called as Srot. You are a Srot of energy to many, and definitely. So just going back to 2000, actually 3rd June 2000, where this book called as Reinventing India, and then you addressed with APJ Abdul Kalam, where the whole ideology of what India should be and India would be was thought through. So looking back there, what was your feeling? And now at 2020, I would just eliminate the part that current state, but how, where do you look India is right now, and in your perspective?
I think India has moved forward. India has moved ahead. There is no question about that. I mean, not too long ago, we talked about $450 GDP per capita. Today, we talk something close to $2,000 per GDP per capita. But GDP per capita is not just the indicator. I think what GDP per capita does not measure is the human happiness, the quality of life, whether the inequalities have vanished, whether disparities have vanished or not. So I think in terms of raising our standards of living, as an average, we have done well. But the difference between the rich and the poor has become even more. And that was even clearer during the pandemic. You could see the migrant laborers and the children and the grandfathers and grandmothers and pregnant women walking several kilometers in today's India. So, you know, I mean, this is not done. So I would say we have done quite a lot in terms of progressing, in terms of GDP per capita, in India being counted among the nations who count, India being the third biggest economy in terms of per, total GDP, although not GDP per capita, our becoming a startup nation, for example, we are the third fastest. And then there are a number of things in which we have become actually number one. India demonstrating that we are experts in frugal innovation, for example. We beat the whole world. We always talk about doing 10 times better and 10 times cheaper, what is called as affordable excellence. You know, so in terms of innovation, we lead the world in that. In terms of innovation, particularly when it comes to denial, whether it was space, whether it was atomic energy, etc., we have demonstrated our capacity. Mars orbiter mission, for example, we became the first country ever to be successful in the very first launch. Nobody else has done it. Even US has not done it. China has not done it. So there are lots of, I would say, big pluses. My disappointments has been with regard to the inequalities, the poor. We have not been able to pull all the poor above the poverty line. And during this pandemic, actually, some of the poor have become extremely poor. Oh. In fact, worldwide, you will see that in 3 months, 71 million people have moved from extreme poverty. I think that's my only, I would say, concern.
Wonderful. I think definitely pandemic would definitely impact in a way that the weak become further weaker, and it'll attack the weak most. As far as even health, if you take any of the element, weak link will get impacted the most, I believe. I was also looking at, a kind of a competitive spirit that you have, in which you say, I was just reading about your dialogue with Mr. Amartya Sen about the Nobel Prize, the way that you were confident, and the thing was that 10 times better, right? Do you see that competing with self is the kind of a message that we should have for ourselves?
Yes, and I'm seeing, I mean, very frankly, you might say, why? I mean, this dangerous optimism, where do you get it from? Very frankly, I get it from our young people, our Yuva Shakti, the power of the youth. Because today, Jyot, he inspires me, or she inspires me. I'll just give an instance in terms of aspirations and how they look at things. I was talking to some students, and then I was trying to sell them that, look, higher education in India has created so many great people. And I said, look at Satya Nadella. He's a product of Indian education, and he's today the CEO of Microsoft. Look at Sundar Pichai. I said, he's a product of higher education in India, and he is now CEO of Google. So I said, one day you can also become Satya Nadella at Google. So one young fellow got up and he said, sir, you got us all wrong. You don't understand what goes on in our minds. I said, why? What happened? So he said, in your generation, your only desire was to go to US somehow. Came the next generation, their desire was to go to US and get a job in Microsoft or in Google. The next generation, not only go to US, go to Microsoft, but become Satya Nadella, the CEO. He said, not my generation. We want to build our own Microsoft, own Google here in India.
Superb.
That is the aspiration, you know. So these young people with aspirations are our greatest strength, as a matter of fact. And that optimism that they have, we should learn from that and try to support them so that they realize their potential and the talent.
Wonderful. I think when we are speaking about youth, the collaboration between academia and industry plays a major part. I am aware that you play a lot of role in bringing this together in the form of providing excellence centers, center of excellences, maybe eventually incubation centers for that matter. So do you think that we have enough infrastructure built for students to be, you know, eventually become employable, as it is called, as are we there, or are we still kind of moving in our steps?
No, see, look, I'll be very honest with you. I remember in Australia, I was invited to speak at a major event, and Saul Singer from Israel, who has written that world's best-selling book, Startup Nation. He gave the talk, and then I had to give a talk. And I honestly admitted, I told him that Saul, Israel is a startup nation. India is a starting up nation.
Starting up nation, okay.
So we have to make a lot of progress. Now, yes, we are the third fastest growing startup, etc. And that's wonderful news. And you are seeing now, for example, what our startups have been able to do. Many of them have become unicorns, etc., etc. But we need to do much more than what we are doing today. For example, government has done some wonderful thing by making life easier for them, helping them in patenting, speeding up their patenting process, taking care of, like, I'm co-chairman of Maharashtra State Innovation Council.
Right.
And we have got a startup policy which is very aggressive, which is trying to help. For example, tendering process. A startup has no chance if the normal tendering process, which goes for experience, it is almost like asking a 15-year-old Tendulkar who hit a Ranji Trophy century, but we'll have to wait for taking you into test because you don't have 10-year experience.
Right.
You get my point.
Yes.
So you can't expect the youth to do that. So we have to create separate processes, which we have done, actually. Like in Maharashtra, we have done. Like there was a startup where developed drones, which can move on the surface of water and do cleaning. Wow. And the Pune Municipal Corporation gave him direct tender, you know, without the competitive bid.
Wow.
And so go ahead. And then he got a breakthrough, and then he is now in so many cities. So such things, and venture capital, it has become a vulture capital. We have to make it into adventure capital.
Adventure.
Angel funding has to come. Risk taking must become sort of more prevalent, you know, because many of these young people are so bright that they will do things which have never been done anywhere else in the world.
Right.
So you cannot say, has the US done it, has Europe done it, then we will do it. So that entire mindset change. So I would say we have begun a 1,000-mile journey by taking the first few steps, but we are a long way to go.
Right. Now, whenever we speak about this innovation centers, incubation centers, typically those tend to be focused, and I'll stand corrected if I'm wrong on that, but tend to be focused on more technology, IT, information technology kind of space, more of a state of the art kind of focus is there. And I believe that even NCL started with this kind of a setup under your guidance. But do you think that for MSMEs like or some focus on manufacturing, there is lean cluster, existence of lean cluster where that conduit eventually leads to some degree of optimization to the current processes and operations. But do you think that kind of a focus on manufacturing also is required now, more fundamental?
Oh, yeah. There is no question about that. Because what has happened is that young people, of course, like the digital. Okay. But what happened? If you look at the physical and biological, it is far more difficult. See, for example, in the digital world, you can, I remember Nandan Nilekani once, I was chairing one meeting where he spoke and Govindrajan spoke, and he talked about, we believe in 363. Now, what is 363? He said, we think of a new product, it takes 3 months to launch it, we make money for 6 months, and then within 3 months, we get rid of the inventory, 363. Then I had to tell him, if you are not in software, but in drug development, that months has to be replaced by years. Years plus 6 years plus 3 years. So that requires patience. So what happens is that digitally, it is very quick to move. So you will find that many people have become billionaires within no time at all. Physical work. Supposing you are developing a particular component, physical component of a machine, you will have to do a million cycle test. Without that, you will not be able to incorporate it. It has to go through all the sort of
rigorous testing.
And biological is even more difficult. If you are putting anything in human being, they'll make you first do human trials, phase one, then phase two, then phase three. It will take years. Like today we are talking about vaccine. It is not just going to come up like that. It is going to take some time. So I believe that there is a clear need for startups to come into this space, and that is happening. If you come to NCL Venture Center, which I started when I was a DG, and Dr. V. Premnath, he's a MIT PhD, by the way, but he's dedicated himself to that. There's a fantastic center. And you will hardly see anybody doing e-commerce there. They're all things that you and I talk about, manufacturing and creating. See, for example, during this COVID challenge, they have done a fantastic job. You know, they were the ones who created membrane oxygenators, for example.
Wow.
And the number of other sort of things that they have done. For example, this MyLab, which has done the diagnostics, it was incubated in you will see that the physical, biological, and mechanical, and other spaces, electronic, and other spaces, there are lots of startups, and we need to do it. Otherwise, what is that? If it goes after e-commerce and easy money, that's not going to happen.
Yeah. The whole life cycle, as you said, is different as far as the physical manufacturing or. Biological aspects are concerned, and I think that has to be catered for in the all the incubation or initial phases as we move. So I would so as we speak about entrepreneurship, a question always hits my mind that there is a thought process that in entrepreneurs are born. Some say that, okay, entrepreneurs could be made. Some say that entrepreneurs could be educated. So what's the perspective? And if at all those are born, maybe 3% is the population, then we want to have so many entrepreneurs. Is that the kind of a jigsaw puzzle that you can give a perspective on?
Yes, I think you have to go back into history and see how the most preferred job was always that of the civil servant. IAS and ICAS officers were both respected, if you remember. And it was all service orientation, particularly job, a service in the government. So entrepreneurship started very late in India. I'm not talking about exceptions like Dhirubhai Ambani, who from a petrol pump attendant. Today, if you look at Mukesh, he has become the fifth richest man in the world.
Absolutely.
But these are exceptional stories. Tata's, for example, it goes a long way back.
Right.
If you start looking at examples where people started, you know, from small beginning and became big, those are rare stories. I mean, for example, I remember I was on the TDSCI Venture Capital Company, which was, which was ICICI subsidiary, which was the first venture capital company of India. And I remember this was in mid-80s. And at that time, we were trying to promote technopreneurship, but it was very rare. And then we picked up somebody like Kiran Mazumdar. I remember she started in a garage with 10,000 rupees. And today, she's one of the richest women. Those were exceptions. Or Pramod Chaudhary, we supported him at that time, you know, who created these biotechnology companies. Today, you know, his renewable source-based alcohol plants are there all across the world. 8% of the alcohol that is produced is produced by his company. So those were rare exceptions. But now what has happened is that with the incentives that have been given during the last 5 years, the idea that rather than seeking job, I'll create job, you know, that has changed. Like the IIT director was telling me last year that hardly anybody used to go and start his own company. He said now, one out of four graduates wants to start a company.
Wow.
Yeah. This is a big change. Otherwise, previously it was quite different. So I think that environment has come and people now recognize, because nothing like success leads to success. And success, people have seen how people you know, can get into that space and can have an opportunity to grow.
Wonderful, wonderful. I think such examples are definitely motivating, where we as a nation move towards getting more and more entrepreneurship. Creating of the job becomes the say, yeah, rather than, you know, we get employed and try always to be secured under covers. So I think that's amazing. Another thought that I was playing with was, you know, entrepreneur is somebody who gets an idea. So there is definitely a difference between a creator, innovator, entrepreneur, business, I would call incubator, and then eventually running of the business like an operation and scaling it up. So do you think, I mean, this is all where that entrepreneur at times gets stretched, if at all the person is just a creator of a new concept, and then he or she is not able to scale up. I mean, is that somewhere that we have to segregate these definitions, or there is a little bit of confusion?
No, I think what we are looking at as a single person, as an enterprise, I think that would not be correct. I think that is where I would refer to what Narayan Murthy has said in terms of startup. Because as you remember, he borrowed 10,000 rupees from his wife and started sort of a startup, as you know. And they had founders like Nandan Nilekani and Chris Gopal Krishnan, etc., etc. Now, what he points out is that each one of them had different strengths, by the way. The five founders had different strengths. Everybody was not a technology guy. Some were good at marketing and sales. Some were good at the other attribute that a business needs, for example. Some were just strategy thinkers. Somewhere having, you know, that what I call as a convening power to get investments, get financing, etc. So it is a combination of those four or five that work for Infosys, and Infosys is a big success.
Right.
So our idea of a single person doing everything is not correct, actually. It's the team that matters. For example, Jio GenNext, which is an accelerator, you know, which was set up by Reliance when it set up Jio. I remember Mukesh Bhai started it, Mukesh Ambani started it, by saying that I want to create next generation Reliance and next generation Dhirubhai Ambani.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. I was the chairman of the Reliance Innovation Council, the chair of the venture fund and so on. Now, what we do always in the criteria that we use, because we get some 2,000 plus applications from which we can take only 10 or 11.
Mm-hmm.
Like day before yesterday, we could took only 11. So that we look at the team per se, not a single individual.
Okay.
And do they have these complementary skills to sort of take it forward? So it's always a team. It is never an individual.
Oh, amazing. I think this, because the kind of limited exposure that I have with MSME, I see that the leader at the helm tries to do everything, and then there is no sense of delegation. There is no sense of awareness of succession planning. Yeah. And then that's where...
This is true. For example, if he's a technology guy, he will only keep on talking about how great his technology is. But technology is just one piece, They are changing market, they are changing competitors, they are changing human needs, they are changing behavioral economics, etc., etc. He has no idea of that at all. He's just stuck by that. That is why we have created what is called in my book, Leapfrogging to Pole Vaulting. If you read the chapter 3, we have looked at what is called an assured framework for success, for assured success. And that assured is affordability, scalability, sustainability, user-friendliness, rapidity, excellence in terms of technology, and distinctiveness. Okay? Now there, for example, affordability is obvious. Okay? Scalability depends upon so many factors. Okay? Sustainability is based on not just economic sustainability, because you can't live on government subsidies, but environmental sustainability, because if you are not green, you not survive. Then the social understanding of social behavior, changes of social tastes, etc., etc. The user, the you part of it, you can create a great product because you think it's good for the user.
But it has to be
So we use that assured framework, and if you start looking at those elements, basically, it makes a whole difference. So getting that holistic perspective is not possible for a single person. He has to get all that. And in fact, for example, the NCL Venture Center, in fact, they wear t-shirts where they say, "Are you assured today?"
Okay.
Because all these aspects, technology is great, but this goes all beyond technology, what I'm talking about.
All these are soft aspects.
Yeah. So these are extremely important.
Wonderful. As we were speaking about, the entrepreneurship and specifically MSME as a category, adoption of technology. I mean, there is a lot of discussion about it, but it seems like there is a natural resistance and large corporates like Infosys, TCS took some time to get that going whenever that working from home was to be considered. Has to be a pandemic to be reason for that. For MSME, I see that technology has to be something that has to be horizontally populated. So what is your perspective on that? And is something that you are seeing on the horizon where, it will come across the MSME where all these aspects of technology would be adopted?
See, this pandemic has created huge destruction of lives and livelihoods and economies, etc. But it has created something new also, which shows, as a matter of fact, the power of digital technology. The fact that you and I are able to talk to each other is because of digital technology.
Absolutely.
The reason for the first time Reliance had 3,07,000 of their shareholders joined from 12 different countries is the power of technology.
Yeah.
The fact that we are able to work from home is power of technology. The fact that today 1.69 billion children are out of school, but still they are not missing school, is power of technology.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So therefore, digital is not something, or technology is not to be considered as something which is on the periphery. Mm-hmm. It has to be at the core. So no business what you are in is a technology business, according to me. And if you fail to use technology, you will not survive, you will not succeed. Even a kirana people today, if you can see, Mukesh is trying to do, he's trying to take technology to them.
Wonderful.
Yes.
I think with whatever vision that I have heard about where Jio is connecting the kirana, if you see in pandemic, what shops were open, those shops were open.
Yeah.
So those are like veins. And those are not threatened by any of the existing big malls or anything. They have been surviving. They have their niche differentiator. And they might not have grown to larger sizes. But I think he is able to pick that. So just some perspective about the Jio. What do you see, the digital and technology in the form of collaboration, social aspect is likely to go? Maybe you can take example of Jio that will bring that this.
No, I'll tell you, Jio is a phenomenon. Jio is a phenomenon. Jio has transformed everything.
Mm-hmm.
You remember, we used to give a missed call.
Yes.
Very frankly, missed call was a jugaad. And in missed call, you did not pay for anything, but the company lost.
Yeah.
They are making a call, somebody has to bear the cost. And we did it because it cost us zero. Now you don't have to do that because Jio said, I will give you a voice call which is free.
Absolutely. Mm.
If you look at data, for example, it used to be 150, 200 rupees per GB. He brought it down to 5 rupees per GB. Okay.
True.
So therefore today, video, et cetera, has become sort of a norm. And it has become brought in social cohesion. One day, mother met me, widowed mother, whose son is in army and is posted somewhere in Chandigarh or some outpost. And she says, video is so cheap now that every day or every other day, me, his wife, and his children are able to see him and talk to him.
My goodness.
That was not possible 5 years ago. That's a social transformation.
Absolutely.
If you look at deaf people, deaf and dumb people, they couldn't talk on phone because they couldn't talk. But hey, you have a video, both people have video, and by using sign language, they can communicate with each other.
My God, yes.
So 400 million Jio customers, for example, enjoy this. And that is the power. So this is a digital inclusion. Mm-hmm. You know, we always talk about digital divide. He has brought in digital inclusion. I think that's what we have to understand. Because bulk of the time we say, oh, he became the fifth richest man, etc. But nobody talks about the social transformation that he has brought in by
brought
doing
in.
This.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. Actually, that takes me to another adjacent topic of bottom of the pyramid, the way Professor C.K. Prahlad does. And this dimension. Now, in entrepreneurship, as we typically we look at some target market, but very rarely we see that, and we always talk about as the innovation grows into form of a startup, we talk about number of hits, we talk about number of headcounts, number of patients for that matter, but we never get into idea of hitting the bottom of the pyramid. Is that something that you also feel? Maybe it is something that I am getting that feel.
I think basically what people have to understand is the following. See, we have this idea. In fact, there is a K.R. Narayanan memorial oration that I gave in Australia. And there I talked about what is called as CSR 1.0 and CSR 2.0.
Mm-hmm.
What is CSR 1.0? Corporate social responsibility. What are the idea of corporate social responsibility? You get into a business, you make a lot of money.
And then, give
then
back.
One day you say, oh my God, what did I do for the bottom of the pyramid? The poor. And then you create a trust, you create a foundation. Like Bill Gates, made a lot of money. And then one day he said, oh my God, I must do something for the poor. And he created Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation.
Right.
That's great. And it's doing great work.
Mm-hmm.
But that is doing well. And doing good. So you first do well for yourself and then do good for the society by giving scholarship, by doing this. But there is what I call in that paper as CSR 2.0, which is doing well by doing good.
Okay.
Let me doing good itself is a business. Now let me give you an illustration. In my mother's name, I have created what is called as Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award.
Oh.
Inclusive Innovation Award. It's a small sum, 1 lakh. We give. This year I'll be giving 2 lakh because there is normal award plus COVID related award. Mm-hmm. And we give it on 17 November, which is the day she passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And there, if you see the startups, for example, the entrepreneurs, what they are doing is doing well by doing good. For I'll give you, this is the 10th year. I'll just take two illustrations to explain to you.
Mm-hmm.
For example, one of the awardees was Rahul Rastogi. What did he do? His father had a challenge with his heart, and in the middle of the night, he had to take him to hospital for ECG. So ECG, you know, you lie down and then reads up.
All that has to be attached.
Yeah. Takes half an hour, then the nurse takes out the thing, you know, that and so on paper. So he said, he's a wizard, technology wizard. And he said, why can't we create a portable ECG? So he created something which looks like this. It is not that, but it looks like this.
Like this.
Very much. Mm. So the way it works is that you put your two thumbs, like I'm doing now, for 15 seconds. Then you have a sensor at this end. This is your heart.
Oh.
15 seconds, 15 seconds, 15 seconds, above the heart. 15 seconds, 15 seconds, 15 seconds, below the heart.
Okay.
Okay. And if you have downloaded an app called Sanket, your ECG directly goes to any expert that you talk about.
Wow.
So there could be a poor woman, old woman in a village, and if they had connectivity, all this is like using a thermometer. She can do that, and the ECG can go to the best expert in Puri.
Super.
Yeah. Now, you will say, and by the way, this is Sanket. You can buy it on Amazon. It is 2,500 rupees. Very, very cheap.
Absolutely.
But the cost of doing that, if you really calculate ECG, is 5 rupees. Mm. Not 200, 500 rupees. Just 5 rupees. Second awardee, Meer Shah, breast cancer, when you have, as you know, its detection is very painful, mammography.
Mm.
So he said, why should that be the case? And he created something which is non-invasive. It is called iBreast, which is just move around the breast. And within 5 minutes, it tells you whether you have breast cancer or not. And the results can go to anybody that you want. Cost, $1.
Wow.
Per test, $1. And he's going now to the country. Now, why I'm saying this is doing well and doing good? Because both of these, all right, Sanket as well as iBreast are profitable companies.
Ah, okay.
And yet what they are doing is doing things for the bottom of the
bottom of the ground.
So it is not that versus that. It is doing well by doing good. Doing good itself can be a business.
That amazing. Yeah, wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful examples, yeah. I think.
And these are 9 examples that I have. For want of time, I can't give it. This year will be the 10th. And last year's, I'll tell you, last year's one, again similar. As you know, there is a challenge with manual scavengers.
So,
you know, society looks down upon them.
Upon them, you have to go.
Their lives are in danger. They go down and no masks, so toxic gases. Their average life is 30 years. They drink because the stench, they can't survive, etc. They said, why? They said, manhole itself is a bad idea. Man in the hole. Why should man be in the hole? Why not machine in the hole? Mm. And they created a robot which can actually do a better job of cleaning much faster than the man. Okay, then you say, oh my God, what will happen to the jobs of these guys? They took care of that by saying that now they will teach them how to operate the robot. So their jobs are not lost. But their dignity goes up because their children in school, others will say, father is a manual scavenger. Now they will say he's a robot operator.
He's operating the robot.
And it's a profitable company today.
Superb.
So I'm just giving you 3 examples. If we had 2 hours talk, I would give you all the other examples.
Amazing.
I myself experiencing it, and we are honoring these people, we're helping them to build businesses. So why can't we do that? That's the
right thing. Right. I mean, the message is very clear. Take a pain point which is absolutely clearly defined, and let the masses get that experience and benefit.
And you will make money not by just high price and low volume. You'll make by low volume, low price and high volume.
High volumes. Exactly. That's the message. Now coming to the current state where, you know, there have been talks about China. Will not go in controversies, but there is likelihood where we will stop importing or we will get opportunity to replace imports. There are some spaces in China where you have OEMs already having set up that might move to India. You see exports from China might also be an opportunity. So in your perspective, how does this pan out as an opportunity for India?
I think that my first message will be this idea of boycott China will hurt us more than it will China.
Oh, okay.
For a simple reason. There are certain areas we are very heavily dependent upon China. For example, we are in drugs and therapeutics. We are the best producer of generic drugs in the whole world. In fact, the whole world depends upon us for affordable drugs of high quality. But there are what was called as active pharmaceutical ingredients, APIs. Mm-hmm. From which we make the drugs, finished drug. 70% of it we are importing from China. Mm. So tomorrow, supposing we say boycott China, that means no China. That means not 70%, 0%. All right. 70% to 0%, what happens to the drug industry? It will collapse. Mm-hmm. So my message is, it is not China-less. It is less China. Then less and less China. Mm-hmm. And then less and less China till we come to no China. So it has to be a graded policy, basically. Right. Electronics, for example, 45% we have. Okay, suddenly we can't. We have to look at alternative sources, but we have to start. So that's why when our Prime Minister mentioned about, I mean, created this vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat.
Yes.
I also agree. I mean, that's a great idea. But Atmanirbhar Bharat has to be with Atmavishwas. And also we have to have what is called as a strategic patience. We can't be in a hurry, otherwise we'll be hurting ourselves. And we went for them because they were the cheapest. It is not API is something we could not do. Our best strength, very frankly, is in process chemistry and process engineering. But what happened was that whatever we were producing, they would sell is 20 to 30% cheaper.
Cheaper.
Because they had the scale, they had so many other things going on and government subsidies and so on. So we said, fine, we are getting cheap, so we'll buy them. Mm. Okay, that is how we closed down our API.
Now
the government has announced, and I must applaud the government, if you see their announcement now, they're investing very heavily now in creating APIs within India. There's a government notification, which I just saw in the morning. So that is the graded policy. But if you say next month, all 70% will be clear. No, next year, no. It will take some time. So my suggestion is that we don't look at China less, which means zero China, but less China, less and less China. And it has to be kind of China plus one. Let us understand that. Second thing, see, the size of the Indian economy is small because many times, you know, we say, oh, domestic market is big enough. I know, but look at the total economy. We are a few percent of the total economy. Mm. So if you want to grow big, we have to export. We have to take a size of that big pie and get it inside. That's what China did, isn't it? Now, in order to do that, we have to create high quality export. Mm. And for high quality export also, we have to depend upon Chinese goods. For example, I heard Rajiv Bajaj. Mm-hmm. He says, I export 15,000 crore worth two-wheelers. Mm-hmm. But in that, there's a 1,000 crore component that I get from China. He's dependent on that. Mm. No, because of this, he will move from 1,000 crore to 0 crore. I have no doubt about that. But it will take time. You can't snap your finger and say from tomorrow, this 15,000 crore, this thing will go off. So I would say strategic patience and not China-less, but less and less in China.
So basically having a phased approach, also have patience to make sure that, you know, whatever importance we have created over a period of time is strategically.
I will give you further statistics. For example, that is what is called as foreign value added, FVA.
Oh.
Foreign value added means because of the foreign component that you get, how much additional value you create. Right. So if you see the percentage, and we import from everybody, we import from South Korea, from Europe, from US, etc. Each of them contribute 5%, 6%, etc. China's contribution last year was 34.1%.
Oh.
One third of all the foreign value added today of our exports comes from there. Do you want to drop it to zero? So we have to have a strategy. We have to be sort of patient, because I've been hearing these slogans, but I'm giving you very frankly my view, because to me, India first.
Absolutely. I think a gradual reduction of whatever that we have adopted over a period of time, it will take.
Should do it speedily. I'm not saying go too slow. Like government is moving on API very fast. There's a sense of, I think we should do that because we have all the capacity to do that. I'll just give you an example. Pandemic came, PPEs, personal protection equipment, 70% of it we're importing, 70%, right? Today, do you know, we're exporting within 3 months.
Kya baat?
Our industry was capable of doing that. So Excellent. We are capable of everything. It's the question of our saying yes.
Mindset, even I see, frugal innovation happening during this pandemic time where even ventilators have been produced by a couple of examples of some of the IT engineering companies. Some were also, but Mahindra made one of the ventilators.
Yeah, that is true, but that is not Mahindra's core business.
Absolutely.
You get the point. It was nice of them to have come. But I'll tell you something more direct about that. And this is where our industry, they're doing good. Harsh Mariwala created Marico Innovation Foundation in 2003, when innovation was not a buzzword like today it is. And I've been his chairman since then.
Oh, yeah.
And they created, he and Amit Chandra, they put in 2.5 crore of their own money to create a grand challenge. And they picked up among all the things that we require, just two things, personal protection equipment and ventilators. And they put up a grand challenge. And I was the chairman of the jury, basically.
Solid.
Since you talk about ventilators, let me tell you the ventilator. So there are three who have been given the awards. And if you look at the three, what they have done is extraordinary. They have created ventilators which meet the same or similar class, specifications. As something like world class, but at cost which is 20 to 30%. More importantly, they have created ventilators which you can't import. You know why? Because they have created it for Indian conditions. What are the Indian conditions? In rural villages, there is no electricity. So they say this can work without electricity. Suddenly, even when you have electricity, there is a breakdown. So they have created a system by which it can run for 8 hours without
no interruption.
Then you require medical oxygen. Many times that is not available. So one of them has created something where the air that you have can be used because the enriched oxygen can
inside. Wow.
Then there is a shortage of trained operators in ICUs. Trained people as the skin increases. So they have made it so user-friendly.
My goodness.
Yeah. That it can be operated without that. And none of them were in ventilator selling business. Like KPIT Technologies, we got it. I'm the chairman of KPIT Technology Innovation Council.
Right.
Their business is in software and software services. But Ravi Pandit's heart was in the right place and he said, we'll create. And they have created a unique product.
True.
Similarly, there is another one, Anoka, who have actually were in IT startup. They were in robotics and they went into automation, So what I'm saying is that our capacity, that's why I said Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atma Vishwas, self-confidence. that we can do that, and we can do it with Atma Sanman. I mean, we are capable of that, you know. So I think that is the spirit.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Very inspiring. It's quickly switching to another space of electric vehicles, you know, hybrid vehicle, electric vehicle. There is a lot of buzz going around it, and I believe, to my limited knowledge, definitely some OEMs are sitting on the border. This is going to come. The wave is there. Two-wheelers, maybe three-wheelers are moving a little bit, and you will see some disruption happening in that space. But in your perspective, you know, what's likely to happen? Maybe the two-wheeler, three-wheeler segment will move first. Four-wheelers might...
Yes. Two-wheeler, three-wheeler will move first. But there I have a word of caution based on the experience that we had. Just as when the pandemic came, and suddenly the drug industry was hit because the APIs were not available for a short time. And of course, they became available. In the same way, we have to worry. What do our electric vehicles work on? They work on batteries.
So,
right? Now, those batteries are lithium ion cobalt based.
Cobalt, yes.
We don't produce lithium. Okay. Right. We import it. And China has acquired many mines across the world. Right. We have not done that. So we don't have access. Cobalt. We have to depend upon Congo, which is a rogue country.
Oh.
So anytime,
batteries.
If all your vehicles are EVs, anytime these materials are cut off for any reason,
this dependency.
Therefore, you have to look at alternatives. Now, the alternatives are fuel cells. And in fuel cell, you burn hydrogen with oxygen and you generate electricity. Okay. And that requires a special technology. And I'm very happy to say that through a public-private partnership, which has started, it is called New Millennium Indian Technology Leadership Initiative. Right in Pune, Dr. Ashish Lele, one of the most brilliant scientists, has created fuel cells which are better than the best.
Wow.
In terms of its performance, you know, Ballard, they beat them in several performance parameters, but costs, which are one-fourth. And all components are indigenous. They have done vendor development. Okay. Now what we have to do is to give a chance to this. But now having developed that technology, that is not good enough. There's a policy that has to back it up. For example, what is the policy? Look at, we have more than 600,000 towers. Okay. Today in the country. And they all burn diesel. Okay. Because our power supply,
that is the way
all over is sort of $2 to $3 billion worth diesel is burned. What does it do? Pollution, right? Now, these fuel cells, they compete with them in terms of price, and therefore they can replace those.
Right.
So just as we have declared so many things overnight in the past, why don't we say that from tomorrow, you know, all the diesel generating sets will be replaced by our own indigenously made fuel cells.
Yeah.
So diesel generators will not emit particulates, will not burn $2-3 billion worth diesel, which we import anyway.
Yes.
Basically, you know, over 70% we are importing today our fuel requirements.
Right.
But we'll be having something of our. So our people like Ashish Lele and his team, and they have done partnership, by the way. There are Reliance has participated, KPIT Technology, Thermax, Ford Laboratories. They have all come together to create that. You know, there are more than 20 patents. American patents. We have the technology. But it has to be backed up by a policy. And overnight, things can change. Just like what we did. We said 59 apps, Chinese apps. And suddenly our apps got the sort of boost. Like you see what happened to Chingari.
Yes.
Within 2 days, there was such a demand, their server crashed, actually. So you create an opportunity, you know?
Yeah. I think what I'm finding in you is a perspective of always looking ahead, looking maybe beyond what everybody can think of. I think that's amazing. Thought engine that you have under you, that actually takes me to maybe one of the last ones. I think I would not like to stop this flow of knowledge and energy, but so I think a little bit on patriotic side of going against the patent of against turmeric patent, and I feel really proud there that whatever is ours. I also refer back to Vedas, and you see the yoga is being popular outside. I mean, we should not realize it from others that you had a great heritage, but I see that you were behind this fight for the patent. Just have would like to hear it from you to feel great.
Well, many times small acts create big changes. Mm-hmm. It was a small act, and the way it happened was also very interesting. I just don't think from here, I think from here. So one day my mother, my wife were sitting, I was the NCR director at that time, and mm-hmm. we're sitting in Pune, in the balcony of our house, and suddenly a bird came and with broken wings. Mm-hmm. And I remember my mother rushed and got some
water and some
haldi.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The turmeric powder, and she created a pest, and the bird died after a couple of hours, and we had fallen in love, and we all cried and all that. Then I was in Delhi as a DG of CSIR, and one day I picked up Times of India newspaper and found that a US patent was taken on wound healing properties of turmeric. Mm. I said, what are they talking about? My mother knew it. My mother's mother knew it. For generations, we have known it. How can you patent? Because patent is always given for something which is novel, something new, So in the morning, I read that paper, and in the evening, I declared that I'm going to fight it. Now that itself was bold.
Superb.
That itself was bold because I was Director General of CSIR, which gave me all the freedom in the world. But I was also Secretary to Government of India, which took away all that freedom, because without government's permission, I could not do anything. I should have taken permission. Minister, but I said wrong is wrong, and that was a historic fight, because within 14 months we provided the evidence and that were cancelled. But it had a miraculous effect because that was the first time such a patent was challenged, because they were always doing something and claiming rights, etc., etc. And that then, of course, I was lucky. I got became the chairman of the World Intellectual Property Organization, Standing Committee, etc. And there on information technology, and there were 176 nations. And I told them, because they did not used to recognize traditional knowledge as knowledge.
Wow.
So okay. I challenged them. I said, knowledge generated in Harvard, Caltech, MIT, Princeton is knowledge. And knowledge generated by my predecessors in the practice of life is no knowledge. How can that?
Amazing.
Yeah. And then I went to US patent office and showed, I have challenged only one, but you have thousands of patents which are wrong. I took some samples. I took our Sanskrit shlokas,
right,
their English translations. So what you say is new has been done by predecessors. Then they say, what do you do? Because we don't know what is there in your mind or what is there in your old books. So that is where we got the idea of creating a traditional knowledge digital library. And there are 4 crore pages of digital library where all that knowledge has been put in a mode which is international patent classification, so that patent examiner understand that.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's, and that means it is not just we are rich in traditional knowledge. China is rich, Latin America is rich, Africa is rich, and so on and so forth. So all their rights were protected as a result of. Now, many people ask me, why did you fight it? It was that ministry job. I said, no, I fought it because I'm an Indian. They have done something wrong, So we have to take the responsibility, and it has made such a difference now. No wrong patents are being given now, because this is always being sort of referred. But what I'm also saying is that all that knowledge is with us now.
Right.
So let us not just take pride and say, oh, this is mine, I will not. But use that knowledge to create new product. Basically, because this has been done by experiential empirical learning. I'm saying, that's why I have been promoting what is called as a golden triangle between traditional medicine, modern medicine, and modern science.
Modern science. Mm-hmm.
Bring them together. And you can create new products, like, for example, what we did when I was CSIR DG. When you have Ayurveda, you always you will find Trikuta there, and one of the ingredients is black pepper.
Mm.
So we found out what was there, and there was piperine. Piperine used to do bioenhancing. Bioenhancing implies that the availability of drug in the bloodstream increases.
Oh.
Yeah, same amount. Okay. So you, in effect, you don't have to take 6 tablets. 2 tablets will do, and you'll get the same therapeutic effect.
Super.
So we put that knowledge together, did scientific study, did clinical study, and there is a new product called Resorcin that has been launched on the basis of that. So what happens, this is for TB. So TB patients can only take half the amount of drug that they were taking, less toxicity, less cost. But that knowledge came from what was there in Ayurveda, coupled with modern science and modern medicine, the clinical trials. And we have kind of a, such knowledge. That's, I think, right. We have to use it.
Absolutely.
In order to create our own niche. Nobody else in the world will do.
Amazing, amazing. I think it is speaking to an encyclopedia. You have so many things that you have to share. I would say that I never wanted to stop this flow, but end of it, I would like me म्हणेन की शुद्ध आपल्या मातृभाषेमध्ये आपले जे आप्तजन आहेत, काही काही वाटतंय की थोडस लल वाटतंय की अरे काहीच होणार नाहीये, तर त्यांना थोडस मराठीत, शुद्ध मराठीत मेसेज द्यावा असं मी तुम्हाला विनंती करेन.
नाही, माझ्या मते जसं मला मगाशी दुर्दम्य आशावादी म्हटलं, तसा मी दुर्दम्य आशावादी आहे. आता हे जे पॅन्डेमिक वगैरे आहे, हे काय पहिल्यांदा आलेलं नाहीये, ह्याच्या आधी आलं होतं, हे जरा जास्त सिव्हिअर आहे, आपण याच्यातनं परत येऊ, त्याच्याबद्दल माझ्या मनात तरी काही शंका नाहीये. आणि या पॅन्डेमिकमुळे आपण बरंच शिकलेलो आहोत, कळलं की नाही. जसं आपण म्हटलं का, आता डिजिटल तुम्ही आणि माझ्याशी बोलता, आता बरंच आपल्याला त्याचे फायदे होणार आहेत, कळलं का. डिजिटलायझेशनमुळे डिकार्बनायझेशन होणार आहे, आता जसं वर्किंग फ्रॉम होम, कळलं की नाही. पॅन्डेमिक गेल्यानंतर सुद्धा वर्किंग फ्रॉम होम 50% लोक करणारच आहे,
चालूच राहणार.
त्याच्यामुळे मग ते पेट्रोल वाचेल, डिझेल वाचेल, ट्रॅव्हल वाचेल, वेळ वाचेल, वगैरे वगैरे वगैरे.
बरोबर.
तसंच एज्युकेशन फ्रॉम होम ते ऍक्सिलरेट होणार, आता ब्लेंडेड हे येईल वगैरे. तर आपण ही जी पॉझिटिव्ह साईड आहे, याच्यातनं आपण काय शिकलेलो आहोत, कळलं का. जसं आता क्लायमेट चेंज, ह्याच्यामुळे आपल्याला क्लायमेट चेंज खरंच झाला तर काय होईल याचं ट्रेलर मिळालेलं आहे.
Listen, get
it, disruption of supply chain and supply as well as demand. हे जे मॅसिव्ह हे झालं, त्याचं अँप्लिफिकेशन तसंच होणार आहे. आणि त्यामुळे आपण ह्याच्यातनं धडे घेऊन पुढे जायला पाहिजे. आपण जसं पाहिलं की आपण आता रिकव्हरी बोलतोय, रिकव्हरी आपण रिकव्हरी इकॉनॉमिक रिकव्हरी पाहिजे
बोलतोय,
पण आपण दुसरं काय पाहिलं, ही ह्युमन ऍक्टिव्हिटी जेव्हा बंद झाली होती रस्त्यावरची, तेव्हा यमुना पहिल्यांदाच तिचा ब्लू कलर
दिसायला लागला.
आकाश पहिल्यांदाच दिल्लीमधलं
ग्रेवर
दिसायला लागलं. तर ह्याच्यावरून आपण शिकलेलो आहोत काहीतरी, की आपल्याला परत म्हणजे इकॉनॉमी रिकव्हर करायची आहे, पण एन्व्हायरमेंट आपल्याला ती रिकव्हर करायची नाहीये. यातनं आपण जे शिकलो आहोत, तर माझ्या मते आपण या ऍडव्हर्सिटीमधनं नवीन अपॉर्च्युनिटी ज्या निर्माण झालेल्या आहेत, जे शिकलेलो आहोत, त्याचा आपण जर वापर केला तर मला वाटतं त्याचा आपल्याला प्रचंड फायदा होईल. आणि जसं मी मगाशी म्हटलं की या पिरियड मध्ये सुद्धा आपण पाहिलेलं आहे
एवढ्या गोष्टी,
पिरियड मध्ये लोकांनी काय काय केलं, लाईक मुकेश अंबानीने ऍज यू सेड $20 billion ही कुड सॉर्ट ऑफ गेट इव्हन
दिस पिरियड.
तर आपल्याला अशक्यप्राय असं काही नाहीये, हे सगळं शक्य आहे, प्रोव्हाइडेड वी हॅव दॅट पॉझिटिव्ह ऍटिट्यूड दॅट येस वी कॅन अँड देन येस वी विल.
वंडरफुल. I think pandemic is always, we can definitely look at, as you said, blessing in disguise. Apan jasa ghyava tasa hai, ani apan positive is ghyava, ani yachatna multiply karun anik motha, je atmanirbhar, atmavishwasi, tumhi jasa mhanla, tasa Bharat banava, asa mala message vatto. Tumhi evada vel dila, manje mala shabda nahit, I don't have really words to give respects to you. Thank you so much. Doctor, and I would just give this from all of us who are listening. Ha durdamya aashavad asas durdamya hot raho, ani tumhi ani jasti jasta dangerous optimistic hot raho, ashi ishwara char ke ichhale prarthana karto ani dhanyawad manto.
Namaskar.
Namaskar. Sundar.
Namaskar.
बिजनेस कोई भी हो, सक्सेस की नींव हम रखते हैं।
बुलंदियों को छूने की आपके अरमानों की उम्मीद जगाती जोत है, हर सपनों का हम स्रोत है।
सही स्ट्रेटजी, परफेक्ट डिसीजन मेकिंग और बिजनेस ग्रोथ के लिए हम आपके साथ कंधे से कंधा मिलाकर आपकी स्वप्न पूर्ति करते हैं। स्त्रोत कंसल्टेक, सिनर्जाइजिंग ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन।